I'm Brock. I voice Brock Powell. I voice Lyle, or Fist Puncher. One part of a, I would say, a pretty dynamic villain team with my sister Lauren, voiced by Alyson.
Yes, and Lauren also goes by the Destructress. And she's got quite an attitude. She's got quite a sharpness in how she communicates. And I would say she's very self-justified. So if you ever need to find a person who knows how to wiggle their way out of something or convince you of anything, she might be it. Because she does it every day with him.
Right. And so also, if you need someone who just like generally smashes things with intent and malintent, Fist Puncher's your dude.
Lyle!
What? Lorena!
What went through your mind when you sort of first heard about this story? It's obviously Phineas and Ferb-esque, but
yeah.
What went through your mind? What did you think? What was...
I spoke like this for 14 years of my life, so I was just glad to use my lower register, and I've always played the moral compass on shows, and so when Dan said, hey, I need someone to do this 10th voice for this pilot, just come on in, I thought, oh, I can really just have fun with this, because I'll never be the villain for real, and then here we are, and this is a blast, because I get to touch into completely different aspects of who I am as a human, and things that you would never get away with in real life are totally on the table as a Disney villain.
I think for me, when Dan was talking about the pilot, we were... So, Hamster Gretel, I think he's talked about... The idea was born while he was working on Phineas and Ferb, Candace Against the Universe, which we had both worked on. And I just fell in love with the idea of the sibling story and to be the counterpart to that, these other siblings that, I don't know if people know this, but not all siblings get along, apparently. I would never know. But it's a really cool thing to represent that and to be on a show that is so family-centric and also, you know, just... representative of all kinds of family relationships, and I think it's super, super. It's fun, and if I wasn't on the show, I would be watching the show. So that's kind of my relationship to it.
And what I will add to that is, I think it's easy with the comparable titles, Phineas and Ferb, Hamster and Gretel, to assume that it's copy and paste. And while the universes coexist, the sentimentality and the character stories and even the traditions of having a multicultural leading family, there are a lot of different flavors that really give it its own distinct place. So if you loved Phineas, you watch Hamster and Gretel knowing you'll fall in love with the characters because Dan and all of the creative team are genius, and it's going to have its own payoff.
Right.
Would you say you two are like the main villains? Are you the most recurring?
I mean, if you asked us.
Breakfast would totally, heartily agree that we are the main villains. And if you want a photo, we are charging.
I can't say the word
Nemesis, Lyle.
Yeah, we're those. So I think we definitely are an integral part. I am excited for fans to meet our characters and fall in love with our characters and see how often we appear, if often.
I mean, also, there may be other villains.
Very well could be.
Sometimes people play multiple villains in the same show.
Yeah, so I will say that's one of the things Dan and Joa and Sarah Sherman and Kristen Paiva and the entire team behind deciding who voices what characters. Because so you have the writers, and the writers will write with a very specific character voice in mind, and it'll be on paper, and then they go to the casting team, and the casting team will be like, we're looking for, and they have to take the picture of the character, and what happens is, when we're in the studio together, Dan will just be like, well, just try it, and we'll come up with usually a touchstone of like, this celebrity, or it's kind of this character, but make it your own. So on Milo Murphy's Law, I voiced a villain named Dr. Not Sorry, who was sort of like, it was kind of a Rick Moranis kind of thing, you know, Not Sorry. And it was super, super fun to be able to do that. On this show, I voiced Lyle, and I think right now maybe four other villains throughout the series. But I don't want to give away anything because it's a really super surprise.
We've heard about one of them, Big Baby.
Yes, I do voice Big Baby. Big Baby is my baby. I love this character so much. He is... you know, a politician who's got an attitude problem. Again, I can't compare that to anything that's
no
happened to them.
None
at all. But he kind of talks like this, and he sort of kind of gets angry, and he's kind of like the Hulk, but he can also sometimes sound like a baby. And it's a, you know, a little like Jerry Lewis kind of thing. The team is so encouraging and so fun. I never feel rushed. I get to, we get to ad lib so much, and so much of the comedic timing comes from the team asking you, you know, can we do it funny? Can we write it funnier? Can we say it funnier? So,
can I ask you both about your long-term relationship working for Dan? Because I know you were a teenager and you were on Milo's Murphy's Law, so this is something you guys keep coming back to. What is it about Dan or the environment he creates or the content he puts out that makes you want to keep working with him?
Well, first, I may have to clarify some things. As an actor, we don't always have all the power in terms of who's making the decisions about who's on the show. So really, credit goes to Dan for allowing us to be a part of
it. Credit and gratitude. Gratitude, for sure.
And I think what's beautiful is that for me, Dan does feel like family, and there's a sense of safety. You know, out in the real world, I often feel very self-conscious to be super expressive, and so Dan is such an anchor for me that I know there's nothing I can possibly express or explore, you know, tonally or in character that would be too outlandish. And so that kind of safety and trust, I think, really allows someone with my personality to feel like, hey, all right, I can really go for it. And I truly thought I was just helping a bud with the pilot, you know. I'm like, sure, I'll throw my voice on it. How cool that these people are doing these cool projects.
Right.
And there's no expectation, and then here we are.
So we call that scratch, and that happens quite a bit in animation where, you know, so-and-so will call and say, hey, can you come and do this voice? And you never, ever think in a million years that it'll just, because you skip the casting process, essentially, because you came in and you worked on this pilot. So it's,
and it's better to not believe you will get the job, because most of the time
you won't get the job. But getting to work with Dan, my first time working with Dan, I do a lot of creature voices. Dee Bradley Baker is sort of like my spiritual idol in that, along with Frank Welker. Could you have picked a better, like, I'm so grateful, because I learned so much from Dee, and then I came along on Milo Murphy's Law voicing additional creatures and pistachions and all these aliens, and it was super amazing. But I remember I came in, I was just doing one, my first day, I only have one line for one job, and it was Swampy and Dan in the studio, heard me do a thing, I was trying all these, I had prepared, it was an alien, and the alien was like, and it was, I had 10 different ways to do the alien, because I was like, this is my one shot. And I remember I came in, I did the one line, and it was the Feeble Oop. It was the same thing. It's the Big Mac recipe backwards, which is Dan can say it. And so he wrote that out as the alien language. And I remember he literally just watched me do it 10 different times, and he was like, do you have 1,000 voices in there? And I was like, oh yeah, pretty much. Like, it's just something I've always done. And he kept bringing me back, and Swampy kept bringing me back. And I think it was that safety and that feeling of just truly feeling like I could, like, loose and try stuff, right? That you were talking about. So yeah.
Where are you? Like, where are you going into sound studios for this, or are you recording at home?
Listen, the story of the pandemic is that all of us as actors became engineers and technicians and
studio owners, even if it's your closet. Yeah,
we learned how to work software and pipe in on certain ISDN lines and things I never expected to know. But, you know, it was an opportunity to adapt and also educate myself on just how many components go into a successful record from a technical standpoint. And I think what was special is that in a time that was otherwise quite isolating, this became one meaningful way to connect with people you know and love who are outside maybe your traditional family for Melly and Dan. They were just in the house recording. But it was kind of a phenomenal and unexpected transition for us to realize the show literally must go on because there's airtime and we can't have replay, you know, for an entire series for how many years. So, you know, Disney shows, Nickelodeon shows, all these kinds of things. I was learning about condenser mics, and, you know, and they're like, just use the cardioid setting. And I'm like,
you're like, the what?
Google cardioid. Yeah. Cardioid.
It's a heart shaped pattern that comes out from the microphone.
That's true.
Yeah. You can look it up.
Yeah.
Fist punch back.
Have you got like a killer setup at both your homes now? Killer recording studio?
Oh, you would see, and that's the funny part. You would think that after a couple of years, my setup would look rad. And instead, before each record, I'm still scrambling, and I'm like, get some blankets to soundproof. And maybe I'll just, okay, fine, I'll wear the blanket.
Yeah,
and I'll just hold the mic here, and can you hear me? Can you see me? So I'm still working on it.
It's funny, prior to the pandemic, there were situations where, you know, I recorded something for a Lucasfilm project in an airport.
Oh my God.
Because it's just the immediacy. And so I think sound engineering is an incredible craft.
Yes.
I'm not an artist at it. Through the pandemic, super lucky, I have a studio. I also, Bill Farmer, voices Goofy for Disney, is my mentor. We run a business together, but we run a demo business called Toon House Studio, super fun, and we actually have like a private studio we can use. And then while there was some downtime during COVID, I recorded my Candace Against the Universe lines at Ferb's house. So, yes, I went to David Arrigo's, the current voice of Ferb. I went to his studio because it was up and running before
my. Right, we finished the movie.
From home.
COVID.
So I'm in Ferb's house doing. So it's just amazing. It's just amazing. Yeah. And it really is like, it does feel like Toontown. Like we all know each other. And it's really cool.
It's our first time meeting today.
Which is weird. Yeah, it is. I feel like I've known you for 2 years.
Yeah.
Now, is there anything about your own essence, your own physicality that you see in these characters when you watch them? I know they're often like looking at your recording.
That's a great question.
I haven't noticed yet. Actually, maybe I should say this is an opportunity for self-examination. It doesn't have any similarities with Lauren. I might need to rethink some habits.
Wouldn't it be like, really? Like if I was like, really? No.
Really? Yeah, right. But I think maybe in just that I have a movement background, and so some of the more action-packed sequences are probably, for example, when I'm recording, I'm definitely mimicking and creating those gestures. However, the animation team is like genius, so they don't need poor footage of me in the studio going,
yeah.
You know?
It's definitely a game of telephone, and you're taking the words off the page, usually without picture reference.
Yeah.
Sometimes for an audition, you'll get lucky, and they'll show you what the character looks like. In this case,
I didn't know what she looked like.
I had no idea. But it was actually pretty like, okay, no, that was pretty spot on. Because
yeah.
I kind of based him, we have this sort of like, you know, Valley Girl, Valley Boy, Valley Person accent that we kind of both do, I think.
Yeah.
But in my head, I was kind of doing Biff Tannen from Back to the Future, but like a higher pitch voice. So, you know, like, hey, butthead, McFly, but then, like, you know, I had to take it up here a little bit. He's kind of, you know, little raspier. So it's like Polly Shore from Encino Man mixed with Tom Wilson's Biff Tannen. And then the picture, when you see the character, you're like, no, that's exactly what that is. It's literally, you took a little of this. But I didn't sit with the animators and write out an essay saying, like, so it's amazing how the sonic performance can resonate with that.
I think it'll continue to improve, too, or not improve, but we will get to embellish and explore more dimensions as we meet each other in real life and meet the animation team. And yeah, it's, you know, it's like watching the first season of something versus the second and third and fourth, and you're like, oh yeah, now this is like, y'all are just glue, and it's already incredible. So.
I think I'm just, as an actor, I'm so excited for the fans to see the show. Like, this show is ready for an audience, and you don't always feel that way. And I won't say what shows that is, but sometimes you don't. You're like, oh, God, this is the opposite. This is like, oh, okay, we premiere August 12th. Like, maybe, like, let's do it now. Like, let's drop the mic.
Let's Beyonce this.
Yeah, let's Beyonce this. Yes.
Totally. And it's really heartfelt. Like, something that I watched 3 episodes last night just to see how it felt compared to Dan's other series. And because the sibling dynamic is explored and a little bit more... there's just like this good-natured love at the core between Kevin and Gretel. and they're really growing and developing and becoming their own human selves through it. So there's a little bit more depth and like substance to the lessons in each episode. So I'm excited for, you know, young people and people of all ages to really connect on a felt human.
Yeah, and I'm excited for the old people like myself. Only old people. I think animation is timeless. I think it talks and speaks to the kids and kids at heart, and it's so exciting to be here to launch this new show. I'm seriously
over it. Wreak some havoc.
Yeah, fist punch.
is there a particular episode you're most excited for fans to see, for audiences to see?
Do you want the Destructor's Dancer?
I mean, any episode we're in.
Any episode that we're in is probably my favorite.
I think, to answer your question, one of the things that makes this show so different and exciting is it has a Villain of the Week episode. I cannot pick a favorite, because even if I'm not voicing or we're not voicing the villains that week, these are killer, funny characters. Yeah. So you do not want to miss a episode.
Yeah.
You don't. Because you never know who's going to pop up.
Point blank. Can't follow that.